does a Ferrari belong? The obvious answer is a racetrack, or maybe an undulating road in the hills around Modena. A place where the Ferrari dream is sold based on years of heritage, national pride, and unrivaled motorsport success. And yet, in reality, you're more likely to see one here, sandwiched in between two SUVs in Belgravia. Just think about it, your average supercar spotter doesn't head to the countryside if they want to grab a glimpse of the latest metal. They come somewhere they know there'll be a high concentration of automotive exotica, a place filled with expensive shops, expensive people, and expensive cars.
Ferrari knows this too. As a brand, it understands the modern supercar buyer better than anyone, which is why most of its cars are, in truth, no harder to drive around London than a Fiat Punto. I mean, yes, they are wide, but then so's your average SUV. And there's plenty of those around. God.
When the 812 was launched, Ferrari made a very deliberate point of stating that it's a proper, semi-practical grand tourer. Its own research suggests that the average buyer was far more likely to use a car like this on a daily basis than they were, say, 10 years prior. Big, bright red Ferraris are being used as everyday cars more than ever.
I mean, just in case you don't believe me, I park up to do some shopping and, well, look. Don't get me wrong, this sounds ideal, but with all the usability and luggage space and Apple CarPlay, you have to ask yourself whether, in this case, the Superfast name is a bit misplaced. Has this prancing horse got a bit too comfortable in the poshest part of the urban jungle? However, as an average 812 Superfast owner, there will come a day when you'll want to leave the city and drive down to your favourite yacht or castle. And when that happens, you'll no doubt find that the motorway you were planning to use has been shut because of roadworks. So you'll need to find a twisty back route to get you to your destination. And when you do that, everything suddenly makes sense. You know, every once in a while, you drive a car that just resets what you thought was possible. And although the name Superfast might seem like an overly literal joke, there's no doubt that this car has earned its title. Sitting in front of me now is without doubt one of the greatest engines ever slotted into a road car. A 6.5-litre naturally aspirated V12, it produces 789 brake horsepower and 530 pound-foot of torque. And that's enough for 0-62 miles an hour in just 2.9 seconds. All of that without a single turbo, supercharger or even electric motor in sight. This is what horsepower really feels like.
That's not to say it's a crude, naturally aspirated lump, however. Not simply a throwback to a time when more displacement guaranteed more speed. Sure, it's larger than the 6.2 in the F12 Berlinetta that came before it, but the specific power output is also higher. 75% of the parts are new and include a better crankshaft, conrods and piston design, as well as a revolutionary type of triple injection system. Yes, there's more engine to play with, but Ferrari has made every last component work even harder than before.
The upshot of this is a power delivery that is utterly seamless. I can be in sixth gear at 30 miles an hour, put my foot down and just marvel at the way that it pulls so smoothly up to some quite high speeds. It just doesn't seem to have a flat spot anywhere. I've got 80% of full torque available from 3,500 RPM, and it just keeps pulling and pulling and pulling. Instead, you just get a wave of frantic power as the engine nears its limit. You get these little steering wheel shift lights come on, and as soon as they do, it's time to change up at 8,900 RPM and restart the onslaught. Just listen to this.
In truth, though, much of what I just told you is to be expected. Ferrari does know a thing or two about engines, after all. No, the biggest challenge with this 1.6-ton GT car is making it drive like a much smaller, lighter supercar. Essentially, you need to make it shrink. And that's exactly what Ferrari has done. In another example of some very literal naming, the 812 Superfast has something called Virtual Short Wheelbase 2.0. Along with the electric power steering, rear wheel steering, and vehicle dynamic control, everything works together to make the 812 feel far more light-footed and agile. I mean, there's even a Ferrari Power Oversteer function that automatically changes the torque in the steering wheel to help you catch a slide.
The end result is curious because you're still aware of just how big this car is, but it feels tense, pent up even. It's how I'd imagine a Eurofighter warplane, constantly on an aerodynamic knife edge, but kept in place by the various computer systems. And yet, I don't feel like all the technology completely has my back, even with everything switched on. You have to focus, you have to concentrate to drive this car quickly. I mean, you really do. The steering is super quick. The rear wheel steering is anything but subtle. To drive this car smoothly, you have to be so delicate and precise with your inputs. There's a little button down here on the steering wheel and it activates the bumpy road mode, which just softens off the dampers. And it's usually the first thing you activate on a Ferrari in the UK. But for some reason, in the 812 Superfast, it isn't quite as good. It takes away a layer of feel and control that, trust me, you really, really want. But regardless, there's so much grip at the front end, so much traction at the rear. It's literally like it's pounding the laws of physics with the blood-red violence of engineering.
You'd imagine that with such a vivid and frantic driving experience, the 812 wouldn't make the best long-distance GT car after all. And you'd be right. It's quite noisy at a cruise, the ride could be better, and it never seems to properly relax. Something like an Aston Martin DBS Superleggera would be the superior long-distance companion.
Honestly though, in this case, I don't think any of that matters because the 812 Superfast is proof that while cars like this may rarely be driven beyond 10%, there is no doubt about where they really belong. It's almost like Ferrari has tried to justify building this car by mentioning things like comfort and usability and boot space when, in reality, those are just thinly veiled excuses for them to keep on producing this engine and attaching it to cars like the 812 Superfast. And I think that we can all agree, as excuses go, this is a pretty good one.